In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Hi, I'm Deacon Frank Agnoli, Director of Liturgy for our diocese, and welcome to our series of videos on the liturgy. Together, we'll explore topics in liturgical formation and celebration, ministry, and spirituality. Our hope is that these videos will help enrich the liturgical lives of our parishes and communities, as together we strive to continue implementing the liturgical vision of the Second Vatican Council. In the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, Sacrosanctum Concilium, the bishops wrote, "The Church earnestly desires that all the faithful be led to that full, conscious, and active participation in liturgical celebrations called for by the very nature of the liturgy. Such participation by the Christian people as a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, is their right and duty by reason of their baptism. In the reform and promotion of the liturgy, this full and active participation by all the people is the aim to be considered before all else." These videos are intended to help parish liturgy committees and commissions in their work. As our diocesan document on the six areas of ministry states, the primary responsibility of a parish liturgy committee or commission is to foster the full, conscious, and active participation of all in the liturgy. This participation is both internal and external, of the spirit and of the body. In order to accomplish this task, parish liturgy committees must be attentive to the diversity within the parish and ensure that this diversity is reflected in the parish's liturgy and devotions. Committees ought to identify the liturgical needs and evaluate the liturgical life of the parish. Committees are to help form the parish for the liturgy and invite and prepare members of the parish for liturgical ministry and provide them with ongoing feedback and formation. Parish liturgical committees should care for the liturgical environment and help members of the community connect liturgy to the rest of their lives. Committees should help with coordinating liturgies celebrated by subgroups within the parish, prepare a budget that reflects the liturgical priorities of the community, and encourage participation in diocesan liturgies. This would include having liturgical ministers from the parish help at deanery and diocesan celebrations. These videos are also intended to provide liturgical ministers across the diocese with both the theological and spiritual background and practical guidance to be even more effective and intentional ministers in their parishes and communities. Parishes, however, will still need to fill in the gap, as it were, to explain how the ministries are carried out in their particular church. However, these videos can serve as a common starting point across the diocese. Our first task, it seems, is to define what we mean by liturgy. So, to begin with, when you hear the word liturgy, what do you think of? If you would like, pause the video and take a few minutes to think about this, and jot down some notes for yourself if you like. You're back? Good. The English word liturgy comes from two Greek root words meaning work and people. In the ancient world, the word liturgy referred to public works, works done on behalf or for the good of the community. If I grew wheat on my estate and used it to feed the people of my town, that would be liturgy. If I used my resources to build an aqueduct and bring water into my city, that would be liturgy. Later on, the word came to include cultic service, because sacrifice in the Roman religion was seen as part of one's civic duty, essential for the stability and security of the empire. Interestingly, this is the word that the early Christians chose to describe what they did as followers of Jesus, their works of charity, evangelization, and worship. Why? Because they saw that all these activities had something in common: service of God and neighbor. Over time in the East, the word came to mean only the Eucharist. In the West, we lost use of that Greek word completely until the Reformation. In official Catholic documents, we see a comeback in 1947 when Pope Pius XII wrote that liturgy is the public worship which our Redeemer as head of the Church renders the Father, as well as the worship which the community of the faithful renders to its Founder, and through him to the Heavenly Father. In short, it is the worship rendered by the mystical body of Christ in the entirety of its head and members. Sound familiar? It should. The bishops at Vatican II used Pope Pius's ideas in the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy, paragraph 7. To quote, "To accomplish so great a work, Christ is always present in his Church, especially in its liturgical celebrations. He is present in the sacrifice of the Mass, not only in the person of his minister, the same now offering through the ministry of priests who formerly offered himself on the cross, but especially under the Eucharistic elements. By his power, he is present in the sacraments, so that when a man baptizes, it is really Christ himself who baptizes. He is present in his word, since it is he himself who speaks when the Holy Scriptures are read in the Church. He is present, lastly, when the Church prays and sings, for he promised, 'Where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them.' Christ always associates the Church with himself in this great work, wherein God is perfectly glorified and the recipients made holy. The Church is the Lord's beloved bride who calls to him and through him offers worship to the Eternal Father. Rightly then, the liturgy is considered as an exercise of the priestly office of Jesus Christ. In the liturgy, by means of signs perceptible to the senses, human sanctification is signified and brought about in ways proper to each of these signs. In the liturgy, the whole public worship is performed by the mystical body of Jesus Christ, that is, by the head and his members. From this it follows that every liturgical celebration, because it is an action of Christ the priest and of his body, which is the Church, is a sacred action surpassing all others. No other action of the Church can equal its effectiveness by the same title and to the same degree." The bishops at Vatican II also reminded us that the liturgy is what shows the world who we really are, the body of Christ, and what makes us more and more into that body. It is the high point of our life together. From it, everything else that we do flows. The Catechism picks up on all these threads and tells us that the liturgy, this work of and work done on behalf of the people, is first of all the work of God, a work in which we take part. Or as liturgical theologian Adolf Adams succinctly put it, liturgy is the joint action of Jesus Christ, the High Priest, and his Church for the salvation of human beings and the glorification of the Heavenly Father. We echo this truth in the liturgy itself when we respond to the priest's invitation, "Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father," by saying, "May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy Church." Finally, we can turn to the Code of Canon Law for an official definition for liturgy. The Church fulfills its office of sanctifying in a special way in the sacred liturgy, which is indeed the exercise of the priestly office of Jesus Christ. In it, through sensible signs, the sanctification of humankind is signified and effected in a manner proper to each of the signs, and the whole of the public worship of God is carried on by the mystical body of Jesus Christ, that is, by the head and the members. This worship takes place when it is carried out in the name of the Church, by persons lawfully deputed, and through acts approved by the authority of the Church. Notice the phrases that were underlined in the slides. Our worship is sacramental. We use sensible signs. Things like fire and water, bread and wine and oil. Words, actions, all of which point beyond themselves to something deeper. Our worship is a response to God. Loved first, we are able to love back. We respond in praise and thanksgiving, in adoration and supplication. By acts approved, we mean that our liturgy is regulated by liturgical laws and by liturgical books. These books contain the scriptural texts, the prayers, and the prescribed actions that we use in our worship. What persons are lawfully deputed for liturgy? Whenever I ask this question in a classroom, I often get the answer bishops, priests, and deacons, and that's partly true. Our primary deputation for liturgy, as the bishops at Vatican II reminded us, is through baptism. All of us, all the baptized, have the right and the duty to participate fully, consciously, and actively in the liturgy. Liturgy is worship carried out in the name of the Church. It is ecclesial. It is communal. One of the most challenging aspects of a liturgical spirituality is learning to die to myself, to my desires and wishes, and to surrender myself to the rhythms, the words, the gestures, the postures of the liturgy. When we speak of liturgy in the Church, we are certainly talking about the Eucharist, but we are also referring to all the other sacraments, as well as to the non-sacramental rites of the Church, such as funerals, the Liturgy of the Hours, Eucharistic worship outside of Mass, and blessings. That is all well and good, but it can sound a little too heady. In language that appeals more to the heart, theologian David Fagerberg defines liturgy this way: liturgy is the trysting place of God. Tryst isn't a common word anymore. It refers to a meeting of lovers. So liturgy is where God the lover meets us the beloved in sweet encounter. More on that in the second part of this video.
Go in peace, alleluia, alleluia.
Thanks be to God.